Okay, I believe we are live. Welcome everyone to a impromptu Sunday night Blitz stream. And it's about 11 o'clock p.m. here in Minnesota. And as I said, impromptu. I didn't put out much advance warning for this. Only about 45 minutes to an hour advance warning on Twitter. So those of you who are up late U.S. time or waking up really early European time, you're good to go. Hope you can watch. This is an Aussie-friendly stream. Shout out to Squash Addict and Toby, two frequent viewers of the channel. Glad you guys are watching. I know Toby is. I don't know about Squash Addict. So, how's it going, everyone? Give me a shout out on the stream as usual, just to make sure everything is ship shape. Yeah, it could be midnight. It could be Monday already if you're East Coast time or elsewhere in the world. How many viewers we got here? We got 31 viewers. That's pretty good. We'll probably watch that number climb a little bit. Shout out to the usual crew here. Gwen, James, Anton, Fred, Toby, Andrew. How's it going, guys? Notepad, it's not past my bedtime. I'm a night owl for sure, so yeah, no problems here. In fact, I'm probably still gonna go to the gym and maybe watch a House of Cards episode tonight, so. The evenings and late nights do not bother me whatsoever. It's one of the perks of this job. You know, I work mostly in the afternoons and evenings US time, so I don't have to wake up. Charcoal Fender is checking in from Costa Rica. All right. So I'm going to stream for maybe about an hour or so, and I'm on ICC. Probably will play 3 and 5 minute blitz. Let's play a 3 minute game just to start out. Just to get the juices flowing. I was watching a game right here. Let's turn our attention to another one. We'll just watch a 1 minute game while we're waiting. Tankist88 versus Ozus95. What are you doing at the gym tonight? I'm probably gonna run tonight. Yeah, I'm probably gonna get on the treadmill a little bit. I've been getting back into running more often lately. And it feels good. I think running is the most primitive and fulfilling form of exercise you can do. And it always feels good when you get a sweat going on the treadmill. I much prefer running outside, but not very practical this time of year. Although today it was warm in Minnesota, so I could have done it. Alarcon MI is the first opponent. Let's start with E4. He's 2086. He's giving the peace sign in his avatar. Okay, let's play Knight F3. E6. All right. I'm gonna play B3. I've been experimenting with these B3 setups. I don't know how great they are, but they're playable. Okay, now let's play D4 and maybe try to transition this into something else. Bishop D3 looks okay. Defending the pawn on E4. D6. All right. Let's castle. So I'm gonna fianchetto this dark square bishop. I don't know how great this will be in view of the setup that Black is on his way to adopting. He's looking for a hedgehog type setup, but maybe I can poke and prod and create some weaknesses. Like, let's play Queen E2 just to reinforce E4. He played an early Queen C7. Maybe I'll go F4 and try to play for F5 and thereby attack that pawn on E6. I like the look of that. Yeah, let's do this. So he could advance E5 and hit my knight, or he could play Knight C5. He advances. Where to bring this knight? Let's go here. As I'm envisioning someday maybe jumping into B4 or E3 and trying to get into D5. He could play Knight C5, but I think Knight E3 should control the center reasonably well in that case. Yeah, let's just make this maneuver right away. G4, G5 could be possible going after that knight on F6. Thank you, Max. Max says go JB. Moro says Team Scandi. How's it going, Moro? Knight C5. Let's. It's an annoying move. Because that hits this a couple times. I'd really hate to have to play Knight D5. That's not in the plan for me. I don't know though. Maybe I'll have to bring this knight back. Because how else do I defend this pawn? Knight D5, yeah, it's really not so desirable. But nor is Knight C2. Knight G4 would just lose a piece. Take, take, take on D3. All right, we're going forward. As much as I dislike playing this move, because I feel like he's gonna take on D5, and then I'm gonna have a pawn on that square rather than a piece, as I would like. So that's why it's not so good. He takes with the bishop, all right. Let's take with this pawn and open up the attack on a6. Get ready for him to take back here. He does not, though. Okay. So I should probably get a rook over here. I'm going to do that. I know he can play something like queen b6 and threaten some nastiness on the diagonal. Actually, this could get really bad really fast. Because if king h1... Oh gosh, this is not good at all, guys. Okay, I'm going to do this, but I think I'm going to be in for some pain if he takes and then plays knight g4. I guess I have queen g3 there, and I might not lose immediately. But it's dicey. I'm in bad need of the fire emoticon already. Or you can play that one right away. That's also a good move. Can I take on c5? Take c5. Maybe has some distraction value. Let's do it. So trying to win g4. If I had taken on g4 on the previous move, he goes knight takes d3. Maybe he didn't anticipate this move, though. This might bail me out. Yeah, he takes h2, so let's step here. So I'm going to go after this knight next. Queen takes c5 or rook takes c5. We take the knight. Knight g4 he could play, but I just take it then. This rook is pinned, note. I have 1 minute and 7 seconds. John, you should do a Scandi-only stream. That's like every day on here, though, Remy. That's nothing new. Every day is a Scandi-only stream. Okay, so he's probably going to back it up to h6, I'm guessing. I'm going to play king g2, so I got to play fast now. I do have all these entry squares covered on the c-file, which is nice. I'm thinking about maybe f6 at some stage. Maybe next move. Probably I should have played it on the last move if I was going to do that. Yeah, let's do this now. So trying to go knight h4 and up to f5. If he ignores this, then I'm going to go rook h1. Like if he plays some move like rook c8 or plays g6, rook h1 is looking decent next move. Okay. I know he can play queen e3. Yeah, that's a possibility. Let's go attack him. Now the h-file is not going to be that useful. G4. What a4? Or bishop here looks good, attacking the d6 pawn. Trying to force him on the defensive a little bit. Okay, now I'm going to come here, threatening bishop a5. I'm working my way into the position. Let's take that. And let's play a4. So trying to induce a trade, and then I think his a6 pawn is going to experience some trouble now. If rook b8, I can take d6, so how does he defend this guy? He plays that. Okay, let's just take. And then we're going bishop c7 next, attacking this pawn. If he plays bishop a3, I'll go bishop b5. I can take here. No worries. Let's do this. If bishop e3, I have bishop e2, importantly. But this might not be good enough. Yeah, he can play rook a2 now. But can I go here? I'm going to try this. This is perhaps interesting. If rook e1, I have knight d3, I noticed. Otherwise, I'm not sure I was getting out of that second rank pin. So this pawn is covered by my bishop. He can't take it. Let's just back this up. Let's push d6. And already he can't stop that pawn. I cover e8 and e7. Checkmate. Okay, so we pull off the victory. That got very dicey, though, right around the moment where he had both those knights, one on c5 and the other one coming into g4. I think if you would have just switched up the move order and played knight takes d3, queen takes d3, then knight g4, that would have been better. Maybe queen g3 covers, but I'm not so sure about that. Thank you, Jennifer and Ibrahim, for the fire emojis. And for anyone else who put that. Hey, John, do you have many friends who you talk to about chess, or do you mostly work on your own? Mostly my own, Steve. I'm not actively training with someone or studying even with another person. Truth be told, I just don't have a lot of time to study on my own. That's the main reason. I have a lot of chess friends, but not ones which I'm actively working with. Thank you, The Kai. Cool, Danny. I'm glad you got a chance to watch the stream. Glad to hear it. Let me just look at the engine eval of this position. So the engine says play g6. I think I lost the thread when I allowed knight c5. I'm really not sure about this setup to begin with for white. b3 in the open Sicilian is sometimes undesirable. And I felt like knight e3 was a clear mistake. This move had good intentions, trying to maneuver for d5 or maybe support g4, but knight c5 really nicely takes advantage, I think, just hitting e4. But maybe I'm wrong. Yeah, the engine likes bishop c2 here. You guys can't really see that. Sorry, it got cut off. It says bishop c2 is a good idea. And I think the point is that if, say, knight takes e4, knight takes e4, let's say bishop takes e4, and then bishop takes e4, knight takes e4, I would have knight d5 at the end of the line. That's a little complicated, but the engine maybe thinks I can sacrifice the e-pawn and use the d5 square anyways. So I'm not going to focus too much on analyzing, but that would be the case there. All right, Fernando Mata, we got a Scandi going. Second game of the session, right? Andrew says, John, thoughts on season 4 of House of Cards? Pretty good so far. I've only watched, I think, 3 episodes, but I'm liking it so far. Okay, here I'm going to deviate from my recommended move in the chessable repertoire and just play something solid. Let's go knight f6. Defending the queen. Okay, we'll take. And I'll play a6. I had a game like this entitled Tuesday, and it didn't turn out so well. So I need to improve. I'm going to go bishop d7 and then play knight to c6 and offer a trade for this knight on d4. Maybe now I'll go c5, actually, and really try to attack them. I could also play bishop c5, hitting the knight with tempo. That's interesting as well. Let's do that. If castle's queenside, I'm thinking bishop b6. Okay, let's do this. We might get an opposite side castling affair. No, he's persistent. All right. Knight h5, maybe? Looks interesting. Let's go and attack this piece. See where he wants to go. If bishop e5, I think knight c6. And bishop d2 doesn't look so desirable. This just appears to let me develop with tempo. Maybe he missed knight c6. f6 might also have been playable. Here he may have to go for something kind of sketchy. Like, f4 doesn't look so good. Okay, he has this move. Yeah, probably decent under the circumstances. But I'm very pleased with this position I have. Let's play... bishop c6 comes to mind. Castling just comes to mind. Let's castle. If he castles queenside, he might punt this pawn. I think I can just take here now. Note that my knight on e5 controls the pawn on f7, so that's all well and good. Also, my bishop can come to e3 with check whenever. So that's good. Let's play g6. Yeah, let's go g6. If rook e1, or rook f1 rather, I'll just play my bishop backwards. Let's play the bishop here. Try to hunt down that g2 pawn. If rook f1 now, so rook hf1, I might take on f1 on d1 with check, because that would force one of his pieces to retreat. Or if he takes with the rook, I might have bishop takes. Yeah, so he does that. So let's come here. How many viewers are we up to? I was going to check. Just curious about that stat. 194. Wow. People piled in here fast. Okay, rook e1. Knight f3? Knight f3 makes the most sense, probably, but his rook will get to the last rank. Let's come here. Bring the rook into the equation, just defend the knight reliably. I played Fernando Mata in another stream or video recently. Knight a5, striving for activity. Okay. Bishop g2 is interesting, but let's go here. Keep this rook defended. Got to watch that time a little bit. I don't want to get too far behind. Yeah, Fernando Mata is really pulling out all the stops here. There might be some knight f6 issues at the end of this line. Actually, if his a-pawn is hanging, I think I can do this. So let's play it this way. All right, so if he takes c6, I'll just take with my bishop. And then if he plays knight f6 at the end, I can take a4. He's going to do it this way. Interesting. Okay. Let's do this. I think his knight gets trapped. I have this move. Bishop d4 after he takes. This is a nice little twist. So I've taken away the flight squares f6 and g7. And I'm threatening just king d8 or king d7. Trapping this knight. Now he can try to push me away like c3 or b4 or something, but I don't think it'll amount to anything. Corralling that knight. Yeah, e5. looking good. All he can do is hope to attack me and try to create some diversion, but it's not going to work out. If bishop e2, I'll play knight e3. And we're just coming right over here with the king. If b5, I'll probably also play king d8. I don't mind giving up the a-pawn or something. Let's do c6. I think we can play that way, no problem. And we can take here, no problem. If he takes b7, yeah, he'll win the b5 pawn, but he doesn't go for it. Okay. In that case, we'll play to keep it. Let's go here. So I'll just play the king up to b6 next move. Our knight on e3 does a good job of stopping him from playing c4 as well. Attack this guy. Now he's got to play c4 now. Does not. Okay, let's give a check and then bring this back. Start advancing this pawn. Not sure why I'm allowing him so much counterplay right here. Let's do this and then play f4 next move. I didn't have to let his bishop get in behind there and start causing problems. Let's play king d4. I'm going to pre-move that. No reason not to. Let's bring this knight up to d4 and then advance the f-pawn. We're going to go here, attack him. Then we're going to play knight e2 and promote the pawn next move. See if we can somehow checkmate him. You never want to give stalemate in these situations, though. So I'm actually going to get my bishop out of the way. This is like kind of extreme, but it's easier to flag in these scenarios than try to find a checkmate, I've found. So if we had both had like 3 or 4 seconds left, if I wanted to play for checkmate, I'd actually have to stop and figure out where his king is going and how to react to that versus making some moves and using the power of my queen, because it's hard for him to pre-move here when my queen controls so much territory. I think that's an easier way to win that game. So, all right. So we're 2-0 so far. Fred says, John, thoughts on the candidates? Yeah, the candidates is starting on March 11th. Which is, what, 5 days from now? And my pick was Nakamura. I like his chances. Greg Shahadi wrote an article for uschess.org if you want to go and check that out, where he's handicapping the chances for the various candidates. And I think Hikaru has a great chance if he's in form. So, but you never know. It's one tournament. Obviously, anything can happen. It really depends who's on form in these top-level events I found. How are your knees, John? Any early arthritis from the ACL surgeries? Yeah, so Aaron is referencing, I've had 2 knee surgeries. They were a while ago. I've torn both my ACLs, which is your ACL is a ligament in your knee. Controls a lot of side-to-side motion. And I tore them while playing basketball on 2 separate occasions. So I had to get them reconstructed. And I've had a really good recovery from them. I mean, my knees are never going to be 100%, but they're pretty good. I haven't had any complications or issues. So I don't play a lot of sports involving like a lot of side-to-side motion anymore. I don't play basketball. I don't play soccer, stuff like that. But for everything else, it's fine. Like I can run just fine. No big deal. Yes, Chaz, I agree. Just flagging. John, have you seen the Kasparov versus Letterman game? Yes. Yeah, Dave Letterman did play the Scandi. I think he got annihilated shortly thereafter, but he did play the Scandi. What do you think about Donald Trump? Let's just say I hope he doesn't get any further than being a candidate for the GOP. You know, I hope he doesn't win the nomination for the party. I know there's a lot of speculation that even if he gets the votes, that there will be a contested convention, a brokered convention, I think they call it, and he might not even get it. But I think any rational American does not want Donald Trump to have any chance at the White House, and it's getting a little scary now. John, you have a girlfriend? No, I do not. Currently looking. Going out on some dates. Looking for the right one. John, do you play hockey like everyone else in Minnesota? I do not, actually. I have skated, but only a few times in my life. I actually wish I could skate better. So I'm a bad Minnesotan in that sense. I like watching hockey, though. So, yeah, I wish I could put my money where my mouth is when I strap on a pair of skates. So we're playing practice 007. Let's play a Trompowski with bishop g5 on move 2, and let's damage his pawn structure and proceed from there. We're talking about practice. Okay, I'm going to go g3 and bishop g2. This is the same setup that I used in another game recently out of the Nimzo Larsen. It's not bad. A lot of times black will bring this knight into f6. I want to go for c4, so I think I'm going to play knight d2 to prepare that. Yeah, and now let's play h4. The thing is, black can get an initiative on the king side, so you got to watch out for that. Like, I'm kind of curious if practice 007 will castle or not. Knight e4. Yeah, he might just throw the kitchen sink at me with g5 coming up. It's possible. I mean, I should be kind of aware of that. So knight f4 maybe? Yeah, let's play knight f4. Because if bishop takes, I can take with my e-pawn and leave the g-pawn defending the h-pawn. So it should be all right. I'm glad someone got that Iverson reference. Speaking of basketball, we had a guy in the stream at the start, and I wonder if he's here still, named Tyler Zeller. And Tyler Zeller is a 7-footer for the Boston Celtics. And I was really happy for a second because I thought it was him. And he's like, nah, it's a different Tyler Zeller. Although you're probably pretty cool in your own right, Tyler. Yeah, this is what I was worried about, that he might just like try to charge on the king side. This guy really wants to checkmate me. Okay, so what if I take here? I'm going to do it. And then if he takes with the rook, I'll play knight f3 is the plan. Simultaneously guarding g5. I mean, I don't have a lot of pressure on e4, so that worries me slightly, but I think for the moment I can survive. Rook g4, I didn't consider this. Possibly a good move. I'm scared now. I'm very scared. Okay, let's do this. If he goes back rook h4, I'll have a decision on my hands. He's just going to take the pawn. Also a move I didn't even think about. Okay, we're going to go rook e1. I need to play my queen up to f3, but I'm giving this just as a bailout in case I ever need king f1. So a bit of a sketchy opening for me, to say the least. Take here? Nah, it's not working. Knight f3, not leading to much. His knight is so strong. I feel like I got to get out of there. But how? Okay, I'm going to do this. And then if knight g3, I might take on e6 and then play f4 is my thinking. This position is ugly. Yeah, okay. So do I play take and then f4? I'm going to try it. Because I already have only a minute left and he's on the attack. I got to block this dark square bishop. I know I give up control of e4 once again with this move, but I'm just hurting for choices. I'm going to try to play knight g5, I guess, next. And hope. Maybe bring my queen to f3. I fear that simply like knight e4 now is just going to crush me. Yeah, this is totally bad. Yikes. Okay, well, let's take. Probably play queen h3 next move. Yeah, this is already almost losing, I think. Queen in, okay. Let's actually come here. No, that would be bad. Let's come here. He would have rook h8 against that move that I wanted to play. He might even have sacrifices on f4 sometime soon. I'm just running for my life now. He's threatening some nasty stuff like rook h8. I'm going to try to slip away. Don't do it to me, practice. Take it easy. Okay, we're coming here. If rook back to g8, I can play queen h2. Okay, we'll try to swap. He can just trade and take f4 now, is one simple way to do this. Probably the easiest of all. Oh man, this is bad. Okay, let's come here. 23 seconds left. This would be a true testament to my flagging ability if I was able to pull this off. Not even my flagging ability, just my ability to slip away in general. I mean, it would be an absolute travesty if Black didn't win this game. I gotta defend against the Queen H2 mate threat. Whoa, does that work? Ah, very nice. He has Queen F3 at the very end. Yeah, that's a good one. And he could take with the queen. Okay, that deserves a resignation. Yeah, practice just killed me that game. He played G5 at a good time, and I didn't have a lot of good defensive follow-ups after this. Mainly because this knight on E4 gave me trouble. So, let me just see what the computer thinks right around here. But I have a feeling I'm in trouble at this point. Yeah, it's bad. H4. So maybe in this line, if I'm going to castle, I have to delay it. Or, alternatively, after Black plays H5, maybe not play H4 myself. The engine likes C4 here instead. Letting Black play H4, but I do have some counter pressure against D5. Someone asked why my username is Fins. That's in the FAQ that Anton just linked. Our friend Kazi, aka Shering, she created a Fins FAQ a while back, which is pretty cool and funny. So you should check that out. Anton just linked it in the chat. Because that's probably the most common question on this stream. By the way, John, Chessable is working too good. Everyone is playing D4 to avoid the Scandi. Yes, one D4 is the anti-Scandi, so... Do you style your hair, or is it just like that? Oftentimes I wake up and it's like this, but I do usually use, like, a minimal amount of hair wax in the morning. Yeah, this is not completely natural. Although now it's, like, so used to it, it basically sticks up on its own. Okay, let's play another one. I need some revenge after that travesty of a game. Okay, and we play the same player. Practice. He's a double agent in training. Or a secret agent, I should say. Okay. Let's take the pawn on c4. This guy seems to do well with the initiative, so... Oh, and there you go, e4. This is the same line that gave me issues when I played against Julio Sedora on chess.com and Title Tuesday recently. So this guy might know that. Probably not, but maybe he just likes this gambit. It's a tough gambit to face as Black, especially in a blitz game. White gives up a pawn, but they get a lot of stuff going towards the Black King. This is the same line, too. I think I played Bishop B7 here was the move. Yeah, let's do that. You want the bishop poised on this diagonal. How crazy would it be if he, like, move for move repeated what Sedora did? Because in that game, I played pretty well in the opening, and I was winning at one stage, but it was very complicated. And he outplayed me in those complications. I think he played Queen H5, I played G6, and the game proceeded from there. Okay, so this opponent's going to try to proceed without Queen H5. I suppose... Yeah, that's interesting. So if I castle, is there an idea Queen H5 then? Trying to provoke me into playing H6? Because that would be interesting. I feel like I should still castle, though. I mean, I don't see a lot of viable alternatives, so... Like, Rook F8, Knight takes H7, I don't think can possibly be good. So we're going to do it this way. Yeah, now I got to play H6, because Queen takes H7, mate is coming. Bishop takes would not be strong. Well, Bishop takes, Pawn takes, then H6. Seems very risky on the dark squares. Now let's play it like this. And now if Knight E4, I'm thinking F5. And try to strike back, get my Rook involved in the defense. Because clearly, he wants to sacrifice on H6. That's why it's a big idea here. So we have to... have some sort of counter-argument. I mean, maybe Knight B4 trying to go after C2 and also Queen takes D4, but it's a close call. Yeah, like, against this move, I was thinking F5. Let's do that. Strike at the Knight. He doesn't have time for Bishop takes H6. Knight B4 would have been very interesting, but I'm having flashbacks, some PTSD from that game against Sedora. Practice has his number tonight. It's early, man. Give me some credit. Wow, this guy doesn't care. These guys never care about material. Queen here? Nah. Nah, that's... Okay, we're going here. What is he going to throw at me next? I'm up a piece. Okay, so I can defend against this with Rook F7. I pretty much have to. Is there any other defense? Bishop F6? Nah. I guess he's going to take here is his idea. But is that so good? Like Knight F4 maybe as a follow-up? I could even play King F8 perhaps. Yeah, he just does that. Knight F4 seems decent. It's really complicated, as usual. Hmm. King F8. What about King F8? I don't think King F8 is, like, sharp enough. But if Knight F4, Queen G4, what am I doing? I guess I'm taking D4 in that case. Let's do this one. I've decided. I have a minute left, so I gotta hurry. Let's pre-move this capture. I mean, it sort of feels like white should not have enough here. But then I might go and get mated. Okay, I probably got to take, even though that opens the... Okay, I'm going to do this and then take here. Yikes, can I do that? Queen E8, Rook F8. I think I can do this. Please don't hurt me. Oh, he just plays that. Hmm. And now I gotta go here. Is G6 just gonna win now? G6 and I run out of checks. I have Queen F2. But I might still run out of checks. I definitely didn't see all those complications. Okay, I gotta take here. Clearly. Check. Check. Okay. Yeah, let's do this. Check here. So if he goes to B1 or C2, I can play Queen F4. I really have no time now, though. I think this is a draw. I'm gonna offer him a draw. Or just take the draw. Yeah, that's, I was worried that if he did something else, I might lose on time. So I just clicked that draw button. Yeah, it was a draw by repetition. Weird. That was sharp, guys. And he was winning, apparently. So queen takes d4, just throws it away. Queen a5 check, which I didn't look at all. Or queen e7. Hmm. Does white have enough? Bishop takes h6. This felt like it shouldn't work. But just like that game with Sedora, man. Like, they sacrifice a piece, but the complications are always... entailing higher stakes for black, right? Like, if white's attack doesn't work, they're going to go down a piece, but they're not going to get checkmated. If my defense doesn't work, I just lose the game. So that's why it's particularly tough. A queen e8 would have been a good move here. I didn't see queen e8. Point of queen e8, offer a trade. And if white were to accept the trade, queen takes e8, rook takes e8, he would have two pieces hanging. That's a nice one. Queen e8 also stops queen g6, and he can't go queen g5 or queen g4. So, yeah, this is kind of the same story as that Sedora game. Like, this shouldn't work, but as you see, it's a practical decision by white. Force black to think, put a lot of pressure. Here, bishop b4 check is good for some reason. Bishop b4 check, idea knight e7. Yeah, it's just hard to find in a blitz game. M. Piazza is asking... bizarre questions. Okay, let's play another game. I'll keep playing 3 minute. Seem to be getting good opposition, and it's not taking too long to get a game, so we'll keep going. I'm 23:48 in 3 minute. It was practice. I'm just gonna see if this player like lists their name or rating or anything. Not a pretty new account. Not much. Their 5 minute rating is 25:07. 15 wins, no losses. This is a good player. Their 3-minute stats are less impressive, but they're on a tear in the 5-minute pool. Leon says, "Hey John, huge fan, been following you for a while. Thanks for everything you do." Thank you, Leon. Thanks for tuning in. Power Puffer, appreciate you tuning in as well. John, in line with random questions that have nothing to do with chess, what do you think of the Starbucks reward program changes? I think they changed it so you get gold stars for breakfast purchases. I didn't read it too closely, the terms of the change. But as I understand it, you're going to get less rewards points if you're like a regular coffee drinker, as opposed to someone who orders food at Starbucks. And who orders food at Starbucks? I certainly don't. So, okay, we're playing Sparnal IQ. I'm just going to play a simple setup. Let's actually go for f4. We'll be a little more aggressive. Take some center space. Defend the pawn on e4. And let's play knight gf3. Probably looking for e5 in the near future. Play c3, just prop up the center. Sparnal IQ seems like they've done this before. We're having a French-like position. I'm going to play king h1 because this looks useful. I want to go f5. And given the tempo of the play, I think I should. And try to attack e6, like maybe get take, knight g5 in, something along those lines. Okay, let's take and open lines. He just castles. Wow. All right. So knight g5. Look good? Looks good to me. Let's do it. If he takes with the queen on d4, I'm going to play knight df3, attacking the queen and also attacking e5. So he's just going to give up some material. Yeah, he's saying go ahead and take everything. Now, which rook to take, or do I even take a rook whatsoever? I don't have to. I could play something else. Probably leaving it for a move is a good idea. Let's play knight f3. So just bringing this bishop into the action soon. He might take on e5 is the only thing. Like now, So if I take here, he takes with the knight. Okay, I'm going to take here. He's going to take e5 next. But I'm not sure this is that bad. Okay, let's go queen e2. Take here. Nah, we'll just take. And we should probably take here at the very end before he gets any tricky ideas. And now let's play bishop f4, stopping his king from coming to b8. So he's played very fast, but pretty recklessly too. I think his position is just outright bad here. He has a bishop plus pawn for the exchange, but his king's going to have to go on the run soon. Let's do this. Yeah, let's do this rook. We'll keep this rook on the f-file. And he wants a trade, but actually you're going to get caught here, buddy. This is very nearly just losing for him. Rook e6, probably crushing. Forks the king and the bishop, or the queen and the bishop, rather. Yeah, I think this is good. He can't go queen d3 because I play queen takes d3. And there's no other way he can attack this rook. If bishop c8, I can take on g6, he takes h3, and then I take b6. Yeah, he just resigned. So that got bad in a hurry for black. I think he played just too recklessly there. After f5, the position is sharp, but it seems like white may be getting the better of it. I'm not sure. Let's see. Computer likes white. And probably castling queenside and goading me into playing knight g5 was not too good. So I played knight g5 to maintain the tension. I could take on e6 and then play knight g5, but somehow I think it creates more problems if you actually refrain from capturing that pawn and just leave that capture like hanging over black's head for a moment. So. What's up, guitar player Bray? Oh, hey, Justin. It's my buddy Lee. Justin, a.k.a. Lee. He says, been a subscriber since you had less than 100 subscribers. Congrats on all this success, and I really like Chessable. Awesome. Yeah, thank you for stopping by. So Lee is my friend from UT Dallas when I went there for college, and he lives in the Houston area. I assume you still live in the Houston area. He's a chess teacher, one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. So I appreciate you checking out the channel and catching a stream. Yeah, we should catch up sometime. Squash Addict, you showed up. How's it going down under? Lee, you should shoot me your ICC username too if you're ever online sometime. We should play. Squash Addict has currently, I think, the only Team Scandi shirt in existence, and he says he's excited to wear it to his tournament in 5 days. Squash Addict, you will obviously prosper in this tournament, and I hope you come back and tell us how you do. Favorite band, John? I really like Rush, Canadian rock band, legendary Canadian rock band, Rush. Yeah, they're my favorite of all time. My only regret is I didn't discover them earlier. I started listening to Rush like in my early 20s, and I'm 29 now. So. Coleman, how's it going? I'm in the 3 minute pool, just waiting to get paired here. What distances do you run? Nothing too long. I mean, if I work out, I run like 3 or 4 miles maximum. Yeah, I don't go too crazy. Saud is the next opponent. Let's play G6, move one. Even though I haven't had amazing results with this of late, maybe we'll get a Jinji Indian, and we do. Okay, let's play F5. And, all right, I'll play D6 and just reinforce F5. E4 is one of the key moves, of course. Now, how was I planning to play against this line? I have something in mind here, and I'm trying to remember how it goes. Was it knight F6? Okay, I'm going to do something a little weird, guys. But this is 3 minute, and I might be able to get away with it. My idea was knight BD7, but first I think I want to play this move. There's a line in the Jinji Indian where you can actually let white take a bunch of pawns on the king side, and it's kind of cool. And you castle queen side, and you try to just play it in sacrificial fashion. So I'm considering doing that, like playing knight here. It's possibly a bad idea, though. But you know what? I'm going to try it, just for the heck of it. So, yeah, like now we're going to go knight e5. Let him take h7 or whatnot. And play it like a gambit, like a true gambit. He doesn't want it, though. All right, now we might have to take here. We'll do that. I tried to give him the h7 pawn. He wasn't biting. So take, bishop f5 is possible. I guess he could play queen e3 then, but that's not too big of a deal. Let's do that. Attack the queen with tempo. So knight e5. Knight e5 followed by castling long is what I would like to do. Knight e5 also attacks at h2. Knight g4 would get mated, actually. I don't know why I was saying knight e5. I was thinking knight g4, but I just get mated if I play that move. Let's not do that. Okay, what else can I do? Rook f8. I can castle queenside and allow queen takes e7. Seems kind of risky. But maybe I go knight g4 then. All right, let's try. This game is weird already, and I'm down a minute on the clock. That's a bad sign that I was actually seriously considering knight g4, which is a helpmate, essentially. Very bad sign. Okay, let's come here. I'm threatening h2, and I'm also threatening rook e8, perhaps. I say perhaps because he might have a counterargument. Okay, he's going to do that. So chase the queen around a little bit. Rook d7 also comes to mind. Rook d7, he'd have to go backwards with his own queen. Don't know. Let's do rook d7. I got to guard the d6 pawn as well. So we'll play that way. I want to take h2 and then try to mate him somehow, but I don't think it's that easy. Okay, I'm going to take here. I'm having to make some decisions based on the clock now. That much is clear. Okay, let's do that. Bishop f6 maybe? I guess I can play rook e8. Let's come over here. I'm afraid he might sink his knight into e6 at some point and try to mess with my coordination. I guess I have bishop d3 if he does that, though, for now. Time to giddy up. Play fast. Play fast and confident. Okay, let's double up. I wonder if g4 is possible. He's going to do this. Okay, let's play g5. Look for a trade. Ah, there you go. There's the knight e6 move that I was a little concerned about. Guess I'll take. I think my king's going to be kind of weak now, though. once he recaptures. And he can also take g5. This is not so good. Yikes, this is bad. Okay, I'm going to do this, but rook d1, I think, just kills me. Yeah, that's over. I can't defend. Okay. My gambit backfired. It wasn't even a gambit. It never worked out. Yeah, he just took the material. I think right around here I'm doing okay, but maybe everything's fine for white. Nah, he's clearly better, according to the computer. Yeah. The computer hates this entire line for black. But it's a lot of fun, so I keep playing it. I can't help it. Torgir, I'm not going to play viewers right now. I'll save that for a different stream. Just because this is kind of my normal Blitz video as well. So I'm just playing people on ICC. If you're on ICC and jump in the 3-minute pool, we might be able to play. Hi, Mr. Bartholomew. Would you rather fight 100 duck-sized horses or one horse-sized duck? The classic question. The classic question. 100 duck-sized horses, for the record. Yeah, let's get back in the pool. Sam08. There's a lot of tough players in the pool tonight. Like, these 2200s who play, like, very well. So, I need to get in gear. Okay, let's do this. Play d4, and I'll follow with b3 and bishop b2. This is a line I like to play against the Dutch. Just setting up a counter fianchetto. Because once the bishop's on b2, you try to control e5. Is the plan. Okay, let's go c4. Knight bd2. Knight can also come to c3. The plan is queen c2, rook ae1, and pushing for e4 most of the time. How's it going, Isevios? Thank you for making it to the stream. Never thought about visiting Egypt, the slash. A lot of history, though. Okay, so let's proceed as planned here. If knight b4, queen b1 now. I guess I could still play queen c3, actually. Knight takes a2, queen a5, and the knight would be trapped. So I could still do that. So my primary plan is just push for e4. We're still looking to play that way. And for once, I'm ahead on the clock. I hope it stays that way. Sure thing, Benjamin. Glad you could make the stream. Peter, yes, I play poker, or I used to play a lot of poker. Not any time recently, but back when online poker was legal in the U.S., entirely legal, that is, I used to play a fair amount. Yeah, like from 2003 to 2011 or so. I like Go as well, but I can't play it very well. I know the rules and stuff, and I like watching Go videos and Go commentary, but I can't play it too well. Very complicated game. I want to break with e4, but I'm not sure it's feasible here. I could also play for c5 and try to squeeze him on the queen side. You know what? I'm going to play f3 and try to go for e4. We'll open the center. I feel like his bishop on e6 is a little uncomfortable. He might want to move the knight, like play knight h5 or something, and just so his rook has influence down the f-file, but yeah, I'll try to push for e4. Let's go ahead and do it. He's also going to be in time pressure very soon, so maybe we can take advantage. I think if there's just mass trades on e4, I come out on top because he has an isolated e-pawn at the end of that line. John, who would have won in the Fischer-Karpov match had it been played? I assume you mean the 1975 match. I gotta believe that Fischer would have won that match. Yeah. Karpov was good, but he wasn't... I don't think he was going to be a favorite in that match. Okay, let's take on f8 first before taking back here. And then... yeah, let's do it this way. We'll keep the rook poised behind the bishop. If bishop f5, maybe rook e1 is good, is my thinking. Okay, so what's he up to with that move? D5 is very tempting right now, I gotta say. I think I'm gonna play that. Because I don't think he can seriously contemplate taking this. He's going into hyper mode now. 95? How do you deal with 95? I guess he has queen f6 or g7, maybe. Although, I could swing my queen over. Like queen d2 or something. Or queen f2, even. Because if he takes e5, I have bishop h7. I could also play bishop h7 now if I wanted. But I'm going to do this. So yeah, the knight is immune because of that check. Now he's got to find a space for his bishop to go to. And I'm just going to take c6 next move. This just outright hangs this piece. He might have forgot that his bishop was hanging, or he didn't see it. Yeah, he's just going to be down material now. Get this out of the way of any attack, and he resigned. So I like this line. I can recommend this line against the Dutch. In my chessable repertoire, I recommend a different line against the Dutch, but here we got into it via knight f3. So it wasn't d4 on move 1, so that creates some inconsistencies. Against d4, f5, the line I looked at in chessable was knight c3 on move 2. So just a different way of playing. I have played Magic the Gathering. Yeah, I used to play Magic the Gathering, and if anyone out there played with Star Wars cards, I don't know if that was the official name of the game, but Star Wars cards were a thing for a while that my brother and I were into. That's some serious nostalgia. But yeah, I collected Magic. The number in parentheses is material count. Yeah, so this number down here, 26, that's the material remaining on board. Let's get another game in. No plans to play a Blitz tournament on chess.com, Riggy, right now. It's hard to switch sites on the stream without, like, resetting up the screen capture and stuff, so I usually don't do that. Good luck in Texas, John. Get that GM norm. What tournament in Texas? Am I playing a tournament in Texas? If so, I'd like to hear about it so I could make some plans, because I don't have any plans to play anything. I played two tournaments in Texas. One was in November and the other one was in January, but that's in the past. GM Hushinbet created a Patreon account for his subscribers to donate and do some things like coach. And would you be interested in something like that? Well, I have a PayPal donation link, which many people have been so kind as to use. So occasionally I get donations on PayPal, which is great. So I don't have any plans to go to Patreon, although I like the concept of the site. It's kind of like a Kickstarter almost for content creators. So I may use that at some stage. Okay, Amar Sobh is the next opponent. Man, I'm not doing too well. Let's play b6 on move 1. Not doing too well against d4 with g6 lately, so we're going to do something different. And, okay, I'll play e6 and then try to strike back at the center with c5. Just playing a little offbeat at the moment. And he takes. Okay, well, let's recapture. And maybe knight c6. Looks fine to me. Let's play a5. I just don't want him playing b4 at any inconvenient moment. I haven't committed my knight yet. I'm probably going to go knight f6, but I'm waiting to see what he does. Can I do that without running into too many problems after e5? I'm not so sure. Then again, if I had to play d6, it looks a little odd. Actually, I'm going to play d6, even though I have my bishop out on c5. Looks strange, but I'll try to play my knight to f6 or e7 next. Totally improvising here, but what can you do when you play b6 on move 1? What is that move about? I don't understand that move, so I'm just going to go here. e5, that's what he wanted to do. That doesn't really scare me much, though. Okay, I'm just going to castle. If he takes, I'll take with a bishop. He can play knight e4, but I think just bishop back to c7 should be all right. How about knight f5 here? Look good. Yeah. Good post for the knight. Knight d4 could be an issue. I almost want to play knight d4 now, but it doesn't work tactically. So let's do this. And kind of eye this pawn on h2. The fact that the pawn is on a5 is kind of a bummer because my b5 square is weak. That's one issue with this. Maybe I can go knight e4 or knight e5 on the next move and try to offer a trade for his knight. Bishop f4. He might have some idea of playing queen c4. Gonna go here. Try to keep the bishop. I am Indian, and let me tell you, being Indian is actually a great thing. We have beautiful people, and we have ugly people, just like any race. I obviously missed the conversation, whatever you guys are talking about. All right, we gotta take here. He's gonna play bishop f4 next. That's his main idea. I kind of want to put the bishop back on d6 for that reason. But now I'm gonna play this and just look for a trade and go queen c8. It's a little passive, but I think it's all right. Queen there, okay, but can't I do this with tempo? Looks like you just gotta retreat. Queen back to e2, maybe. Queen c3, he's gonna play actively. Okay, I want my knight on d5, so maybe maneuver. Let's do this. Try to get the knight, also opens the bishop. I do have two nice bishops on these long diagonals. I like that. f6 looks good here. Let's play it that way. Can almost take on f3 now and win material, but not quite. Then take on c3 and try to play for a better endgame, basically. Okay, this pawn is under attack though, so we gotta bear that in mind. I think I'm just gonna take, and let's come here. If bishop c4, I can play bishop d5. It's important. And offer a trade. Let's do this. Attacking that c3 pawn. I gotta watch my time. I mean, he's clearly pressuring me on the clock right now. He's gonna do that. Okay, so we better play e5 and try to get this c3 pawn. Now he has knight b5. He's gonna be very pesky, I can tell. Knight b5 doesn't kill me, but it's annoying. Okay, he didn't do it. I'm glad. Let's play king e7 now. Or let's come here. 30 seconds, 31 seconds. Let's do this. Take that. You can play knight d6 if he wants. I think it's about equal at the moment. Let's do this. Take it. Let's go pin him. He realizes the time situation is in his favor right now, though. I'm gonna play a4 next move if I can. Try to fix this pawn on a3. I think this is a good long-term move. Let's do this. Now we have a threat on a3. Let's go take that. Not sure I should have done that, though. I couldn't take c2 because he had rook c1, unfortunately. Let's give a check. I'm just gonna bring this back, pre-move that. Knight f5 being an idea. Let's give a check there. Come back and defend. Ah, knight c5. Blunder. All right, I'm gonna try to blitz this out and see what happens, but not happy I made that blunder. Okay, let's do that. Maybe I can still get something going here. Okay, let's go and attack this pawn. We're keeping our pawn alive. I flagged him and won. That was an atrocious game, and I feel slightly dirty after that result. Well, I shouldn't say atrocious game at the beginning. I think I played the middle game pretty well. He had this annoying pressure and he was just playing fast, which is a good model in 3 minute in any blitz, really. I messed this stage up right around here. So I played a4. This felt like a useful move. a4, fixing the pawn on a3, making sure it can't move. And then going here. What was really annoying in this position is I can't play knight takes c2 because of rook c1. I don't think. Maybe I could play knight takes c2, rook c1, rook f6 check, followed by rook f2. It looks wrong, though. I don't think that works. He might have knight d3, knight b4 at the end. So I got lucky there. He spent a little too much time. I have trouble with these type of players that just move fast, and it's like you could tell he wasn't playing the best moves. Like, he was always playing like the second or the third best move, but he was playing very quickly and consistently. I have trouble with those player types. The Scandi Swindler. I like that. Okay, we're about out at about 1 hour for the stream, but I'll play a couple more. Maybe we're even getting some people who typically tune in immediately at midnight central time to watch the video, and maybe they're going to catch some of the stream. So I'll play a little longer. The Scandi Swindler. I like that. That could stick, Vivan. Yeah, nothing will be posted on the channel as of now, because this is supposed to be my usual video, so it'll be a little bit late. But if someone checks out the channel, they'll see the notification that I'm streaming. Almost 300 viewers. Thank you guys for staying up late or waking up early. Or just working this into your normal day, if you're in Australia. It's like afternoon for you guys. How close are you to the GM title? I'm pretty far from the GM title. I have one GM norm, but I would need 50 more FIDE points plus 2 more GM norms, which doesn't sound like much, but that's a lot of work. And I'm not playing at GM level, so I'm a ways from achieving the title. Did you hear about the computer that recently beat a strong Go Grandmaster? I did hear about that, and I don't know if it's exactly a Grandmaster that it beat, but it beat a strong Go player. And this computer that plays Go is now going to challenge the reigning world champion, as I understand it. Basically like a Kasparov versus Deep Blue type thing. Because a computer has never beaten a world champion. John, when are you going to play Bullet Tournament? Well, I'll play on my regular Bullet Day in a couple days. Might not play till then. Her is next. Okay, let's play something weird. Let's play H5. And then get the hook in with H4. He just whipped off those moves. He didn't care. But now I have a better pawn structure. So positionally, I'm doing very well here, as you guys can see. We've won the strategic battle already, Team Scandi. Okay, let's go bishop g4. This looks unpleasant for white. Yeah, he plays queen d2 to escape the pressure. Maybe e5? Yeah, let's go e5 and just attack that bishop. See what he wants to do with it. I'm thinking, like, pop the queen out to f6 either now or very soon. But knight d5 could be a problem, couldn't it? So let's play a6 first. I'm just going to see if I can bait him into castling queenside. Maybe go b5. I'm anticipating that he's going to castle long, so that's why I'm doing this. Okay, now let's go here. Ah, that's clever. Bring it back. Well, we can still keep our pin. Now he's going to cover. Okay. So let's go rook b8. We try for b4 eventually. He might just castle short and say, you know what? I've got two bishops in front of my king. Big deal. So let's go knight g6. Probably try for bishop e7 soon. He might jump this knight back into d5. It's a distinct possibility. I'll probably just play bishop e7 then. I'm looking at having to castle short myself soon. Yeah, let's just do this. I've got e5 reinforced by both of these knights, so no problem. His bishop on g2 is especially bad. I like that aspect of my position right now. Here I can win a pawn, right? Take and then take h4. That looks good to me. If it's good for the goose, it's good for the gander. I have no idea if that saying applies right here, but I'm going with it. Okay, now if he castles queenside, then I have bishop g5, which is maybe not winning. I guess he has knight e3, but at the very least, it's strong. So what to do if you're black? He's just going to take. Take with a rook or something else. I think I should take with a rook. I don't know. I don't know that it matters much. I'm going to take with the rook. He's probably going to trade and play his king to e2. Ah, so that's what he's going to do. But he runs into this move again. And now he's got to play the knight e3 move. Ooh, and then I can go like knight d4, stuff like that, which looks like a lot of fun. Yeah, this threatens knight b3 check. If he takes, I can take, and I'm threatening e3. I guess he could take h4 then, but I think even that is good for me. Yeah, I was... Wait, can he do that? I guess he can do that. Hmm. I was thinking he couldn't play this way, but... Yeah, check, take. He has rook h8 at the end. I might have messed up. I think this is still good, though. He can take, take, and then play the knight away, but I go back to g5. So that's my point. Do this, and he's got to pull the knight right back, which is, like, really annoying for him. So, rook b8 check. Queen b6 is an option here. Let's go queen b6, because it just gets a piece into the play, into the game. We don't have to take the knight right away. That's important, right? Like, we can hold off on doing that. Now, how to win this? How to win? A5. Let's go A5. Just trying to open lines. If he takes, I'll play queen C5 check. Let's take here. He can't get out of the pin favorably yet. This is a weird game already, right? So if he takes with a pawn, I'm going to play the rook back to A8. Or actually, no, he has knight d5 in that case. What's that move all about? That one I don't understand. Okay, well, let's take here first. I have no idea why he decided to do that. Unnecessary. He's going to trade rooks. Okay, let's do this. I'm going after that e3 pawn. He's just going to be down a couple pawns, and he's going to have a much more open king. Check. Now my bishop is going to join the attack very soon. Let's give a check there. Give a check here. Let's play bishop c5. I didn't see an exact mate yet, so I'll just do it this way. I do want to prevent him from becoming too active, though. Let's go here. Not sure I'm playing this well. We'll see. Queen d5. Let's give a check. Now if king d1, I have queen d2 mate, so he's got to go there. Okay, now we're maybe looking good. King c1, probably forced. No. Let's give a check. I'm going to go here. I'm just going to trade the queens. I don't know what else to do, to be fully honest. There might have been a mate there, but I'm not sure. Okay, so now we're going to have to maneuver a little bit. Try to cause some trouble. Play the pawn up to b4. Go here, attack this pawn. Okay, now we've got connectors. This is progress. I'm down on time, however. Let's go here and try to get the king up. Let's bring our king around. Probably gonna sack. Now we can just go after the d3 pawn. Yeah, and we win. So fairly close one. He made the bizarre decision to play rook h1, which he didn't have to do that. I mean, maybe he got spooked by something after a takes b4, but I thought he was just gonna take back a takes b4. But he did this, and I mean, I went up a couple pawns, plus he has a wide open king. It's sometimes hard to checkmate in those scenarios, because here I'm dominating the dark squares, but I didn't see a mate. So eventually I just traded queens and tried to win with my, three extra pawns, which was surprisingly difficult. I think I messed this up somehow, but in opposite color bishop endgames, there's always that drawing margin. It's going to be harder to win because they can set up blockades on their color complex. Another flag win, yes. Although in fairness, I was winning this game. The goose proverb. Someone was talking about what's good for the goose is good for the gander. Nope, I've never lived in a foreign country. Would be fun to, though. Is there a chess streamer exchange program? Like, can like Christoph and I like exchange places? I'll go over to Germany for a while. He can come to Minnesota. That'd be kind of cool, right? Or I could go to England and live Simon Williams' life. for a couple months. People are talking about Shogi and Crazy House. They are somewhat similar, aren't they? Shogi's a cool game. There's that guy, Habu Yoshiharu, who is a, I think an IM in chess, and he's one of the best Shogi players of all time. I don't know if he's currently world champion. He was not long ago, but he's made a crossover, a transition, if you will, between Shogi and chess, and he's done very well in the chess world. Like, it was clear he was helped by his Shogi background, his strong Shogi background. The guy's like the Magnus Carlsen of Shogi, from what I understand. Yeah, I don't think my liver could take the Simon Williams lifestyle. That's a good point, Adam. If I had to do that, I'd be tapping out. I'd be begging to come home soon. How many languages do you speak? I know some Spanish, but I'm bad with languages. I haven't learned as many as I should. Yeah, I studied Spanish in school, and I can carry a conversation, but it's a problem for a lot of Americans. That's why it's impressive when I see other people streaming chess in different languages. Like, I watched the Chess 24 stream recently, and they were doing a 24-hour stream for their two-year anniversary. And Jan Gustafsson did a stream in English, in German, and in Spanish, like in the span of a few hours. And he didn't seem to have any issue like transitioning between all those languages. It was incredibly impressive. You guys should remember that. I know most of you guys watching these videos are Americans, but we just take it for granted. I mean, like Christoph, for instance, like every one of his videos is in English practically. He does very few German videos. And I mean, it doesn't seem to impact his play at all. I would think it's tremendously difficult, but it's impressive. So we're playing DTT chess. I think I gave him one too many T's. Let's play g3 and bishop g2. The setup with bishop f5 is possible. I don't know that it's that great, but it's playable. I'm going to go knight d1 and try for e4. Try to push that bishop back. So let's go ahead and play this move. This bishop's just kind of floating out here, huh? Let's go queen b3 and see if we can put the question to him. e2 is covered by my knight, so we got that squared away. Queen b6. Mm-hmm. Better defend that d4 pawn, huh? Let's do that. And if trade, then I'll get the open a file. Maybe he'll play knight a6 after that, but I think my knight's going to come to c2 or d3 and try to plug the b4 weakness. Let's play knight d3. So we got kind of like a semi-end game. A queenless middle game, if you will. Yeah, we need to make a big push in this country to learn other languages. I think that's important. Because I feel like my experience is very much like almost every other American's. It's like you're not pushed in school to like learn a language in any real detail. Like, yes, you take languages, but it's very rudimentary. So, okay, rook d8. I'm thinking about playing e5. But I also kind of want to play f4 first. So let's do that and just establish this array of four pawns in the center. I'm trying to make e5 stronger is what I'm looking to do here. He has some trouble still because this knight is stuck on b8. I'm fully coordinated. There's also maybe an idea of pushing f5 and trying to cut off the retreat for his light square bishop. So he's got some things to solve. Wow, bishop c8. It's a funny looking move. He wants the g4 square. So let's play a little prophylactic move. Stop knight g4. I'm just trying to make the circumstances as best as possible to push e5, which I will probably do now. Yeah, let's open this up. This is a nice pawn structure. I'm liking this at the moment. Let's take this way. Wait. Maybe both. Actually, let's take this way. How about c5 in reply, though? c5, knight e7. Nah, I'm going to take this way. This looks worse at first. Like, taking with the up pawn is very natural, but I was wondering if I could run into issues if black were to respond with c5, trying to attack the d4 pawn. Boy, this is looking amazing. This is strategic catastrophe for black. Okay, let's play rook over here. Just these pieces are all clumped together. I want to go knight f6 soon. I could play knight c5 right now, but how can we turn the screws? Maybe b4. Maybe b4 is a good move. Let's do that. I'll try to play c5 and then maybe make like an eventual knight d6 even stronger. Now the challenge here is not falling in love with my position so much that I just get flagged or something. Because, yeah, I have an awesome position, but let's not get carried away. Knight c5 maybe? Or just take en passant? Taking en passant is pretty obvious. Let's do that. I'm going to come here. Nah, that drops the pawn. Don't do that. Nah, but I don't even know if he can take it. Let's just do this. We'll keep it simple. I'm going to play this and then go knight e5 next. Is the plan. Not sure this is best, but it's what we're doing. My 44 seconds. Yeah, so let's do this. And after a swap, he might play knight d7 anyways. I'm thinking knight c4, keep some pieces on board. Just gonna let me take, huh? Let's give a check. Let's go g4. I want to sink my bishop into h4 eventually. But we're gonna keep pieces on the board for now. He's gonna get to d5, he argues. Okay, well, let's do this. F4 is under attack. Okay, let's come here. Not sure this is a good move, though. All right, let's take that. Probably play rook d2 now. I guess he can play bishop e6. He's getting out. Can I do this? Take, take. And if he takes, I have rook f2. Ah, he has bishop d4 then. Wait, what? Does that work? Okay, I'm going to do this. Check. Okay, now I'm winning, but that was sketchy how that went down. That should not have happened. And time is still going to make this interesting. My knight is kind of stuck now, isn't it? We got to get it back into play. Ah, rook e4. I walked right into it. Oh my gosh. How many times have I done that recently? Oh, terrible. Ah, that game was tragic. Oh, that was painful. Like that hurts every fiber of my chest being. I saw it too, right after I did it. Like knight f4, just walked straight in. He even hung the rook, actually. Rook e1, just bishop takes e1. If I would have looked and seen that bishop's move backwards, I would have found that. Oh, brutal game. So I had a real nice position. He somehow got free. Like, f5 is pretty desperate, but he's got to do something. If he just sits there, he's going to get slowly squashed. So, as I said, I was worried that I would fall in love with my position so much that I actually wouldn't win the game. And that's kind of what happened. Yeah, and like gradually, like once he gets the knight to d5, this is a lot less clear because he's ready to play bishop d7 and get free. And at the end, I just, can't even talk about it. That was bad. Like, let's just see the position after knight e4 before we leave this game. How winning this is for white. Okay, it's not as bad as I thought it would be. It's plus 2, maybe 2.5. Black just has trouble here because he has so much less space and his pieces are all kind of stuck on the first two ranks. We can't go out on that one. I got to play at least one or two more before we end tonight. Right, guys? That deserves a scream. Yeah. Rooks have been killing me lately. I've been walking into like skewers by rooks and just double attacks. And the weird thing is, like, my losses lately, I've been seeing the move immediately after I play my move. It's just like, I wish I could recognize it a half second faster. I'd be avoiding a lot of this stuff I'm running into. So that's what's going on in my chess life recently. Organ Ziev. Let's play e4. 21:48. Maybe we'll play a Tarash French. He's going to play the Rubinstein variation. This is the Fort Knox line, bishop d7, followed by knight d7. I kind of know what to do against this, because I used to play this a little bit from the black side. Yeah, and eventually they take on f3, and you actually get a lot of Scandi-like positions out of this. I'm going to play b3 and go c4, and then put the bishop on b2. Yeah, let's just do this. I think I'm going to play bishop c3, just to control some squares on the queen side. He is rushing with the pawn. It makes some sense. In the Scandinavian, you also sometimes do this. Like, there's a couple lines in the Chessable repertoire where this occurs. So it's not a bad idea. Think about going h4. I'm going to do that, just gain some space. So he could trade on b3 and then trade on a1 at any moment. Now let's continue pushing. So long as he's letting us. Probably now he'll play h6, I'm guessing. So I could play something like bishop c2 if I want to force him to make a decision. I think I'm going to do that. So try to get him to take on b3 and... he's going to play this way instead. I could take on a4. Then he might take g3 and try to saddle me with some weaknesses. Let's play the healthier move. We'll do this. And then if knight f6, I'll play the queen back to f3. Plays knight f8 instead. Okay. Well, now I'm going to take this pawn. This looks like a good moment to snatch. With our bishop on c2 protecting, it's going to be hard for black to recover it. Thanks, Stas. Glad you liked the stream. Thank you, Jason. And hello, Thomas, from Hong Kong. So what's the plan here? You're going to put the bishop on f6. I really would like to play d5, but that's premature. So let's do this and attack the pawn on b7. Just start trying to create some issues for him there. Still d5 is very tempting, but not working. Maybe I can do this, actually, and kind of eye that knight. Because if I can get into h7 that way, that would be tremendous. We're playing a little chicken right now. I'll try to get my bishop to f4. Let's do that. Bishop d6. Okay, we'll take. Because he kind of has to take with a rook now. Otherwise, b7 is too loose. Maybe queen f4 here. Yeah, let's do that. If queen d7, I think I have rook takes b7, which is a nice little shot. Although he can play rook takes d4 then. So let's just defend. I'm a bit down on time. He's going to do it this way. But still, I think I can play c5. Yeah, because after all the trades occur on this square, I win b7, which is crucial, and I'm going to have a passed a pawn, and his knight is a lot worse than my bishop there. Still, I don't want to play bishop b3. Okay, let's play rook b4. I'm going to let him take this, because I'm going to go over and win this b pawn. The h pawn doesn't really matter to me. Maybe he can play e5 here. Yeah, e5, I saw that too late. Still, this should be promising, I would think. I mean, b7 being so weak in all lines gives me some... he's going to cover that. This is not going too well. Yeah, I let him get in e5 and then take on d4. And suddenly, well, he's doing that, though. Okay, so let's do this. If he takes, I can actually take on d4 all of a sudden. And his knight is pinned. I think knight takes d7 was pretty bad on his part. That was completely unnecessary. If he had just taken with a rook instead, I think he's good to go. But now he's walked into a pin. Hello, CPT. He says, good morning from EU. Okay, you played a move. I didn't even see that you played a move. So now we're just going to pile up against f7, basically. And I think I can even do this. After all the trades occur here, we have a5. Dragging out the pin. Not even taking would have won, but a5 is nice. Okay, so we win that one. We're at 23-44. I think his decision to let me take on a4 was bad, but I didn't play like completely accurately thereafter. I ran into some issues with the d-pawn. Like already right here after queen d7 is probably not so clear. Advantage white, but... yeah, not what I would have liked. Now he's winning d4. If he would have just taken with a rook, the edge end likes rook 5 takes d7. Knight takes was unnecessary. Yeah, bishop b3, and now the point is his rook cannot remain defending the d-pawn, so I'm going to play rook takes d4 on the next move and just attack down the d-file. Thanks, Fabian. John, what is your favorite site to play on? I like all the sites. I play on three main sites, chess.com, ICC, LeeChess. And I like them all for different reasons. Like, ICC has the best competition. I think LeeChess has the best interface. Chess.com is more of a community. It has a lot of resources. I teach my lessons on chess.com, and I do a lot of my instructional videos on there. So I like all the different sites for different reasons. Am I saying basically a lot? Sorry about that. John, any advice for a 2250-ish blitz player who is stuck at a USCF rating of 2150 because I play too quickly and impulsively OTB? Well, that sounds like a good problem to have, David. Just got to manage your time better over the board. Employ some of my time management. I mean, that I've always thought that's a better problem to have than the opposite scenario where you just have like chronic time pressure problems. So I would assume just forcing yourself to slow down would help you a little bit. Maybe play less blitz online and play more standard time controls, 15-minute games or longer. Okay, I'm going to play one more game and then maybe answer some questions and call it a night. How high was your rating when you were young? My first USCF rating was over 1,000, I think, and I played my first USCF tournament when I was in sixth grade. So let's say maybe like 12 years old. And I made a lot of progress between sixth and ninth grade. By ninth grade, I was a master. So I progressed very rapidly in middle school. I was 2200 when I was like 15. LeeChess is considering Scandi as an inaccuracy. Yeah, when you load a game onto LeeChess, it does sometimes say that the Scandinavian's an inaccuracy, and it counts it against you, which is, of course, a crime against humanity, and I hope they get that fixed soon. When do you think you might stream on Chess 24 again, John? I'm not sure. To be honest, I don't like the Chess 24 interface enough to play on it regularly. It's kind of more of like a European site, not like ICC is just stronger in general and has a better interface. I like the Chess 24 guys, but their interface needs some improvement, I think. So unless I'm playing a match or something, I probably won't play on there very much. Yeah, it's after midnight. All the US viewers are flagging here. We'll try to keep the energy for one more game. I've had a mixed session so far. I think I'm breaking about even on rating. Some pretty bad games, some good games. Mixed bag. Joseph says hello from Oregon. Hello to you too. When is your next dual commentary match? Not sure. I know Niklas. Ooh, we've got a good player. Italic. Okay, I got to take this game very seriously. Let's play d4 against Suat Italic. We'll play c4, move 2. Maybe a Nimzo. Bishop b4, queen c2. Always a high caliber opening. This guy plays a lot of 3-minute. Okay, I'm going to play a3. I'll just play the main line. I see him in the 3-minute pool pretty frequently. Or at least I see him on the top of the 3-minute list, I should say. Because I don't play the 3-minute pool myself very much. The idea of this line is to try to get the knight to c3. So I will do that now. And you often put the rook on d1 as well. He goes for d5. That's an interesting treatment of this position. I'm going to take. Probably he's going to take with the bishop. No, he takes that way. All right. This is new to me. Let's play knight c3. Now, I want to develop. I'm a little bit behind in development, so we want to get that aspect of our position going. I suspect he'll play for c5 based on the way he's played this game. Let's go rook over, just so if he takes, I can take with a rook. Yeah, I wonder how aggressively Black will play this. I think there's a good chance he's going to play h6, like here, or very soon. And then after bishop h4, maybe he'll go for g5, bishop g3, knight e4. It's not completely out of the question. Okay, so if I play bishop d3, what is your response? Probably taking, I suppose. Yeah, I'm just going to keep it simple and play bishop e2. Queen c8 is kind of a funny looking move. He gets out of the pin. His idea is knight e4, I suppose. Maybe I can keep some edge there. So take knight e4. Or maybe I should take on f6 first. I'm not sure. Taking on f6 first would be kind of lame. Yeah, I'm going to take this way. In the interest of time. Okay, so let's play bishop f4. But the thing is, I'm pinned here. You guys see that? I'm a little bit pinned down. Okay, let's take. We're going to offer a trade of the queens, which I assume he's going to take us up on. If rook c8, I think I can play c4 and maybe get rid of my backward pawn. I'd love to play c4 if I could. And he's maybe going to let me. But he has knight e6 as a counter. These GMs, they're good. I'm not sure what to do here. Okay, I'm going to play bishop g3. I'm worried about c3. Very worried about this pawn. Probably just a rook c8 type move is good for him now. Maybe I should have played bishop d6, but he was going to go rook d8. He plays that rook to c8. Interesting. How do I get in c4 and not suffer here? I could play bishop f3, but that's not going to do the trick. I'm going to try it just because I'm not sure what else to play. Knight e6, rook d3, bishop a6. Rook takes d5, rook takes c3, rook d1 maybe. My king is in the center though. I don't like that. I have a minute to my opponent's minute 20, so edge to him in that department. So I think key line, knight e6, rook d3, bishop a6. He's going to do it this way. All right, so let's go here. Got to defend the c3 pawn. Wow, that's a cool maneuver. Okay. Wow. Get a load of that. That's cool. Guess I take. This is a nice one. But is it going to be good? I don't know. Probably rook d3, so I can castle at least. Castle the safety, finally. Took forever to do so, but... Okay, now this endgame is roughly equal. Not sure either side can really claim to be better. I'm threatening rook d8 mate, which is always nice. Okay, let's trade a pair of rooks. I better get some pawns going. So let's do that. Try to bring our king up. Okay. Problem is, his pawns might be faster than mine. Try to get our king up to help out in the creation of a pass pawn. His pawns are just really quick, aren't they? Oh boy. Yeah, I think I'm just losing here. All right, let's take that. Could take f5. And win pretty comfortably. trying something, but it's not working too well. This guy's fast, too. He's not one of these old and slow GMs. Yeah, it's over. Wow. Nice game by Italic. Yeah, he outplayed us. I don't think I dealt with the queen c8 idea very well. This was nice. So queen c8, and I realized too late that his plan was knight e4. I mean, maybe I have to just bite the bullet and take on f6 right here. Like, bishop takes f6, knight takes f6, and try to play the position. But it feels like his knight is getting to e4 almost regardless. Computer says bishop e2 is fine. So where did I play this wrong? Take. Yeah, here I should have played bishop takes f6. Bishop takes f6, knight takes f6, rook takes d4, knight e4. It felt like that was better for him as well. But the computer thinks otherwise. Or maybe bishop takes f6, knight takes f6, and then just pawn takes d4. That could be the better way of playing. So, sorry I couldn't win that one, guys. Yeah, that was rough. The Nimi, I'm going to end the stream real soon. I kind of want to play one more, though, because, yeah, that last game was just an outplay by Italic. Let's play one more. Okay, Sam08 is going to be the last opponent for tonight. Maybe I could have held that rook ending, but his king got very active and he just went over to my queenside pawns and beat me fair and square. So, okay, let's play this line. Queen d8. The famous three, queen d8. Cool, thank you for watching my channel. I can't see your username. You said you came from Chess Network. Glad to hear that. I'm going to play, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to play bishop g4. We're going to be aggressive, and then I'm going to play knight c6 next move and try to take over the center. Try to control the d4 square in particular. Let's do this. He might play g4 followed by knight f4, something like that. We're going for more play in the middle of the board. Let's play e5. Usually I put a pawn on c6, but this is one slightly more accurate, active way you can handle the position if you like. Okay, let's just play bishop e7. So he could take on c6 and try to mess up our structure, but that would entail giving up his light square bishop, which a lot of players are not willing to do here. Let's play queen d7. So now I'm defending here and also eyeing this h3 pawn. Maybe I'll castle queenside. It's not out of the question to do so. g4. Sacrificing is tempting, but I think it's bad. So let's just do this. Is he going to go for f4? He very well could. f4, pawn takes, knight takes, something like that. Yeah, let's do this. Probably going to castle queenside. We'll make this a sharp game. A sharp battle ahead. So if he takes g6 and I take with the h pawn, I wonder if he can play g5 then. I guess I might have queen e6 in that position. Okay, queen f3, so he's lining up against b7. I could play bishop d6. I'd like to go knight e5, but clearly that would just blunder into mate. Knight b5 is kind of hanging over my head too, though. I think I'm going to go here. Maybe try to eye this bishop on e3. But I'm not going to lie, I like white's position. And that he's better, for sure. Okay, let's play bishop d6. Yeah, let's do that. He's holding my bishop hostage. Also, g5 could be kind of tricky to meet. I'd have to play knight g8, which does not look very good right now. So lots to think about. I am ahead on time, though. That's the theme for the night. Try to stay ahead on time so we can flag them. Or vice versa. Fire emojis in the chat. Okay, so if I take here, g5 is looking bad, right? Knight h5, queen takes f7. Yeah, I guess maybe take on e3 then. Maybe. That's a big maybe. Yeah, I don't think I can risk it. Let's do this way. It's kind of gross now. The fact that I had to do this. Okay, knight e5 could be played here. Yeah. Because I'm hitting the queen. He temporarily disrupted his attack against b7, so I can do this. This could be important. So he goes all the way back. Take on g4, make it crazy. Well, I really want to. Take, take, take. Bishop d4. Check h2. Bishop g3. That's probably not working. Now let's do this. We're going to play it safe. I chickened out. Then we're going to go h5 and try to attack g4. Just push. Watch the time. Really got to watch that time. Okay, let's go here. Try to induce a trade. If he takes, at least we're hitting the bishop. Let's take. Let's hide our king. This is going to be a time scramble. I'm going to try to go bishop d6 and queen d6. Or bishop c7 and queen d6, rather. That's the plan. So we created a kind of an artificial battery. Let's go forward. Queen takes g6. Let's do this. He's got some problems with this king. I have a check on d1 I could administer. Check. Not sure I'm doing this well, though. Queen h2. This guy's fast. Okay. This guy's super fast. I'm going to bring up my king to hopefully help out. Okay, we lose on time, but we got the last pawn, so it was a draw. Wow, time scramble at the end there. Yeah, he started going into hyperspeed mode a little quicker than I did, I think. Probably somewhere right around here, he started playing pretty fast. So I had some shots against his king, but I think he dealt with them pretty well. With his rook on e2 always guarding h2, I'm never quite killing him here, I don't think. So that was the issue. I feel like maybe I missed some sort of checkmate. Queen g3 perhaps, king f1. I don't see the mate immediately. My king also was not super safe, like he was taking on c6. What do you guys think? One more? Aaron says one more. A draw is so lame. Got to end on a decisive result. That ending was a blur indeed. I was just happy to eliminate his last pawn. I thought I wasn't going to get the last pawn for a second. Yeah, one more. Let's do it. All right, medieval. I'm going medieval on you in the final game. Let's make this count. Team Scandi, fire emoji up. Just play real quick. Quick and accurate. Let's go for c4. Attack in the center. Okay, he's playing aggressive himself. Let's go here and maybe pop the queen out to b3. This can sometimes be a good weapon to attack b7 and also d5. If knight c5, I think I have queen check. It's always disruptive. So that's the plan. So you're okay with me playing knight b5, you're saying. Okay, let's do it. Bishop back to b8, probably. I guess I can kind of mess with his castling if I play queen a3 or something, but I'm not sure it's worth it. Let's play h3 first, just to see where he goes with the bishop. He might go back to e6. I can try to go knight g5 at some stage, or not right now. I'm going to go back to d1. Not sure the opening is great for me, but I'm trying to play fast. Okay, let's go bishop g5. I'm probably looking to play knight d2 sometime in the future. Okay, now I'll do it. Attack b7. I think he should have taken with his knight there. I'm not sure about taking with the queen. It looks odd somehow. Because now how does he defend b7? It's kind of tough. I guess you could make the counter argument that my pawn on h3 is weak as well. So, like, winning b7 is never going to be a walk in the park as far as my own king safety. Knight c5. All right. Get the rook to c1 with tempo. Maybe b4 was more forceful. So I could retreat my knight and still be attacking him, but probably more principled just to do this. Yeah, and then we're going to take. He's going to take here, but we win b7. And we'll be up a pawn with a pretty good position, I think. I mean, my knight can always come up to e4. I am liking this so far. Yeah, knight e4, he can't go back to e7. Okay, queen g6. Not bad. This bishop, I want to attack it. I want the bishop. Knight c5, maybe. I can play bishop d5 against that. I'll play that position, though. Bishop d5, knight f6 is what I'm thinking. And then take on d5. It'll be opposite color bishops, but I'll have a very nice light square bishop, and I think his dark square bishop will be hurting for squares. This is the better of his two bishops, by far. He's going to play bishop a7. Hmm. So queen b1 doesn't win anything. I don't believe. Maybe just queen c1. Yeah, let's do that. If rook c8, rook c7 is my plan. This guy is aggressive. Okay, knight c5. Can he play rook c8? Rook c8 in that case. Guess he could. All right, we're coming back here. Watch the time, John. Don't get too low. E4. Let's play the queen in. So create a threat in the future on e6, maybe. This queen has to monitor it. Our rook still defends b7. Mm-hmm. Let's go knight c4. I think I can take with a rook. Yeah, I should be able to get away with this. G3 is weak, though. Gotta worry about that G3 point. Bishop B8. Yeah, he's hunting this pawn. Hmm. Take, does that work? Take, take, bishop D5. Not quite. Ah, maybe. I have knight e5 at the end. Okay, I'm going to try this. We're going to try to wrest the initiative away from him. Go here. This is interesting. So if rook e8, I have knight e5. And that attacks the queen, kind of pushes him away. If king f7, okay, I think this works. So he can't play queen f6 because he loses e8. If he takes d5, I can take here. And then he takes e5. I guess he's not dead in that case. But I should be winning. I'm up material. Oh, no! Oh, very well played. Very well played. Wow. Yeah, I didn't see that coming at all. Rook h1. Mind blown. Very nice. Very well calculated. Yeah. Didn't even see it till it appeared on the board. I thought, okay, he takes e5. I'm going to grind out a win like queen versus rook and bishop. Got blindsided. Wow. So that means that the whole combo was not working for me. I assume. I don't think I have anything here then. Knight e5, bishop takes d. If I have to play bishop take, queen takes d5 check, then he can play queen e6 and block. And here I thought I was onto something with knight e5. That's how it goes in chess. It can make a fool of us all. That was brutal. Did you guys see that coming? Did anyone see that coming? They're calling for one more. I don't know. That's hurt my pride. I'm gonna play one more just because you guys are being such great viewers. But that was painful. Like, I'm gonna have nightmares about this game tonight. I mean, it's kind of weird because I don't think either of us can fully calculate all that's happening here after bishop b8. Maybe I should just play rook f3, something like that, just defend this pawn. Let me see what the engine says. Knight d6, but it's not that much better for white. Probably rook takes b8 is faulty. Yeah, you know, he can even play it right here, can't he? Bishop takes d5 and I snatch the queen. Checkmate on h1. See ya. One fewer. I should have quit three games ago. All right, one more. I'm having so much fun. Let's do it. If I win, my blitz rating, my 3-minute rating will stay above 2300. If I lose, I gotta wrap the stream up no matter what. So, regardless of what happens. That is a tough one, Josh. Yes. That's just getting blindsided. Didn't see it coming. Optically, it looks great for white, but yeah, it just doesn't work. -1.5. Black is winning. Maybe I allowed him a little bit too much counterplay. Right here, b4 could be better than rook c1. I thought b4 could get a little complicated, but in retrospect, there's no reason not to play that and just boot the knight away with my pawn. I guess he could still play a6 in that case, but it might be a little bit better to keep the rook on a1, defending a2. As played, yeah, I ended up going up a pawn. Good position. But he was savvy. Like, I gotta give him credit. He used his resources very well. Like, e4? I mean, if he keeps the pawn structure the same, then I'm happy. I'm just gonna sit here and improve my pieces. So he forced me to some tough decisions. Here, bishop d5 was very strong, if not winning, +4.5. Bishop d5 pinning and also attacking the rook. Then I don't have those first rank problems. But naturally, when your opponent plays e3, the first thing you're going to think about is what to do about the tension here. All right, Resorbitors is going to be the final opponent. We got to stick with what we know, guys. Yeah, no mixing it up. I will play queen a5, though. We'll play this line. Okay, bishop f5, bishop d2 is the main move now. He's going to play queen e2. Okay, interesting. Let's play the bishop to b4, just make sure this knight can't jump. If he plays a3, he's not actually threatening anything, so I can just develop. Probably will play a3, though. This is what they usually do. Then we'll play our queen back to c7. Typical Scandi position. Think about playing h6 here just to preserve the bishops. Actually, let's just castle. If knight h4, I can always play bishop e4, so it's no problem. Let's do this. And he's doing some funny maneuvers. Okay, I'm going to play rook ad8. A lot of times they get the bishops out of the way so they can eventually play c4. So I assume that's what my opponent's going for here. I'm going to try to play my knight into f4 to counterattack. This guy's 2055, so I think I should be able to beat him if I play well enough, right? That's a big if. All right, queen e3. So now my knight's just kind of chilling on f4. I can play c5, but I can also maybe just play a useful move like this. Yeah, let's do that. Knight e5 is possible. He's going to go there. Can I cap him on h3 or g2? Doesn't look like it. Knight f6, he's going to go knight e5. But then I can play my knight back to g6. That's probably all right. So let's do that. We'll look for a trade. g4. G4, I have bishop c2. That might be bad. G4, I might have to go for knight takes e5. Yeah, he found it. This could be bad. Bishop c2, rook d2. Take e5, not working so well. What have I done this time? Bishop e4, he's going to play f3. Yeah, I might have to sacrifice. Okay, I'm going to sack here. Oh, man. He just mouse slipped big time. He mouse slipped huge right there. Okay, I'm going to try to take advantage. He has an offer to take back. This is a sign, maybe. Okay, so if I take, he's going to take my bishop. So I'm going to take here instead. What a weird session. Getting blindsided. My opponents are making huge blunders when it's beneficial to me. D5. I do have a minute less, though, so let's try to be somewhat serious. Okay, rook e2, nah. Actually, we can go here, can't we? Let's do that. Attack his rook and also attack d5. You're just gonna take, huh? Well, I can take here, though. I don't think that pawn is quite strong enough on its own. I know I've been having a bad last few games, but I don't think that's gonna work for him. Whew, he resigned. Well, it took some divine chess intervention for us to win this game. Because he just got so excited about his position, he didn't manage to play d takes e5, and he played d5 instead. Let's just see. I think I'm in trouble after g4. Could I have saved the piece? Bishop c2. I thought bishop c2, rook d2 was a problem. Bishop e4 now? I thought bishop e4, f3 was a problem. Let me pull this game up. So I'm going to fast forward. Let's flip this. Because I got wrong-footed with my light square bishop. Here I have to play g5 to support the knight. G5 looks kind of weakening, though. I wouldn't like to have to play that move. Okay, so let's follow the engine and see how we could have saved our bishop. So bishop e4. What if he plays f3? Now go c5. take here. Rook takes. And then you can take the knight. So c5 is like an undermining move at a real convenient time. That somehow works for me. What if take with the bishop? I assume we... Oh, okay, we can just take here anyways. Yeah, I didn't see that resource whatsoever. Instead, I took and... If he took with the pawn, I was going to sacrifice on g4 and try to get some compensation, but you could see the eval. White's clearly better. Yeah, instead he did this, and did I just have bishop e4 to save the piece? Looks like I did. Aha, blocking the attack on e5. This should also be good. I get a lot of pawns for it, but yeah, that other line would have been better, wouldn't it? Yeah, and here he just lost his rook. All right, so session over with. I'm gonna tally up the results. We played quite a few games, actually. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 wins. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 losses and a couple draws. So 8, 5, and 2. Actually, not too bad. I think it felt worse because those losses were especially painful. In particular, this game against Medieval, which we'll never talk about again. Italic just outplayed me nicely. This loss was very painful. DT, T chess. Saud, yeah, this guy kind of just outplayed me, played faster. Practice also outplayed me. So we got legit outplayed in a couple games. A few of my wins were time-ish wins. So a mixed bag for this session. I went down in rating points because I was facing, I think, entirely lower-rated players except for Italic. That was the only guy who was higher-rated than me. So, yeah. I really hope you guys enjoyed this late night stream. It was fun. Even getting mated with Rook H1 was fun. Tiago, I might play a simul at some point. Yeah, it's possible. No plans to at the moment. James, we'll have to save that question for next time. I think that's a tough one to answer. Asking a pretty broad opening question there. I'd love to play Simon Williams for Estilo. That would be fun. Thanks, Dust. Yeah, thanks for tuning in. John, can you tell us what happened with I'm a Dirty Cheater? Lee Chess says he is not an engine. I don't know about that, Cheesy Chess. I think Lee Chess banned him because there's a very high probability that he's an engine. I was told that he didn't close his account on his own. So yeah, if you guys haven't heard, I'm a Dirty Cheater of Lee Chess tournament fame. His account was closed. And I think he was cheating. I actually, in looking at my most recent videos with him again, I went back and looked at some of the games. It seems like he actually kind of grew bolder and was maybe using his engine even more often than before of late. So, and actually, in looking at the three games that I had with him in the previous tournament, it's almost crystal clear to me he's cheating in some way. I think the way he's doing it is kind of clever. He's using some sort of bot that is not being picked up by the Lee Chess mods. But I think there's no way he's a legit player. So, yeah. Lee Chess, I think, made the right call. Yeah, thanks for tuning in, Andy. Glad the New Zealand viewers caught some of this stream. Or maybe the New Zealand viewer, you might be the only one. Yeah, a lot of people beat I'm a Dirty Cheater. But if you look at his games, the weird thing about the games were he could play perfectly when he wanted, and he would also just throw in the most random blunder, right? Like, the first game I had with him in the last Lee Chess tournament that I did, he found this tactic that was like incredible, this idea with Rook A5, if you go back and look at the game. Very tough to see, especially when you're berserking and you have 30 seconds. And he played some moves that match the engine, like number one, and they're not human moves. But then he just gave away the game in a really strange fashion. So I think he did that to get people off the scent. And I had a feeling after I lost that first game, he was going to beat me the next two. And lo and behold, he did. And he played almost, not, I don't want to say perfect, but he played very strong in both of them. And of course, with blinding speed in every game. So it's not about how he drops pieces. It's just, I don't know exactly how he's cheating, but the program he's using, like he can somehow tweak it to not play exactly the best moves every time and throw in random blunders from time to time. It should be very clear to any decent chess player who goes through those games that something was very fishy in them, though. Actually, Amon Hamilton said the same thing. Someone linked me to one of the Chess Bra streams, and he was playing this guy Leverage ICC, who's not the real Leverage, if you know who that is, but like some other account that was created like a day after I'm a Dirty Cheater was banned. And that account, Leverage ICC, had the same imprint as I'm a Dirty Cheater. And Amon was also saying how suspicious it was, and he thinks it's the same guy. So I haven't talked about it much because really, like these cheaters, they just want attention. They want people to talk about them and build up their whatever mystique. But I mean, it's just someone who is messing with people and is clearly wants the attention. So probably about the last I'll say about that. I mean, it puts me in an awkward position because like in this last tournament, I had a pretty good feeling he was cheating. I hadn't completely made up my mind, but in looking at those games, I'm convinced. But how can I outright accuse someone if Lee Chess hadn't banned him yet? They knew about him, they hadn't banned him. I mean, I'm not going to blame Lee Chess. Probably there were complicating factors. But like that's a guy that I wanted to say, yeah, he's cheating, but for a while, I myself wasn't convinced, but towards the end, it was apparent, but he still wasn't banned. So I am glad that Lee Chess finally brought the hammer down on him. Yeah, it's quite the saga, though. I can understand why people are interested in it and posted on Reddit about it. I don't know if Multicast was the same guy. No idea. I mean, they both were mysterious in a sense, and they both played on the server, Multicast on ICC, I'm a Dirty Cheater on Lee Chess for quite a while without being banned. So the thing is, like in chess, I found that people always want to try to ascribe like overperformances to like random luck. Like people want to believe that lower rated players are capable of fantastic things. And yes, sometimes it's true, but repeatedly, and repeatedly doing things like outside of the norm, that just doesn't happen in chess. I remember in 2006 at the World Open where I played a game against Eugene Varshavsky, who turned out to be a cheater. And he was not thrown out of the tournament, but they ended up watching his games towards the final couple rounds. And he beat myself, several other masters. He beat Ilya Smirin in a really nice game. I actually wrote a chess.com blog post about this a couple years ago. And even during that tournament, like, people were suspicious of this guy, but there were so many people defending the dude. They're like, well, like, you know, maybe he's just a genius and he's playing like all perfect moves. And yeah, it can happen. It can happen for a game or a couple games or maybe even for a full tournament. But for people to repeatedly do that, like, it gets like very suspicious sometimes. And it's not just like the fact that they have great performances. It's the weird stuff that goes along with it too. You know, so yeah, we could talk for hours about cheating in chess. It's a huge problem. And it's unfortunate that it happens. I guess it's just something we got to deal with as a community now. Okay, this stream is going over 2 hours, so I'm going to wrap it up here, guys. Thank you for tuning in. It's past 1 o'clock p.m. Central Time. Yeah, I'm still going to go running, Terminoil. My gym is 24 hours, so it's just like one of those things where you swipe your keycard entry and you go in. So I'm going to go do that. Yes, he beat Ilya Smirin. Go look up the game. It's like a brilliant game. Black played perfectly. And what's funny about the Varshavsky guy, he was actually caught for cheating in a Sudoku tournament some years later after the World Open incident. So yeah, the guy not only cheated in chess, he also cheated in Sudoku. And there's a very funny YouTube video of him at the board, this big Sudoku board in the finals of this, like, I don't know what the equivalent is in Sudoku, maybe like a national championship, let's say, with a lot of money on the line. And they were suspicious of him in that Sudoku tournament, probably from Googling his name. And he's like, he's at the board with his pen and he has like no idea what to do because whatever method he was using to cheat was taken away from him at that point, or wasn't able to do it. So he, like, all the two other guys in the tournament are like furiously filling in the squares. And he's just like pausing, pen in hand, like not knowing how to react or what to do. So I know, Sudoku tournament cheating. I couldn't believe that too when I first found out about that. Google it. It's hilarious. Eugene Varshavsky. And I have no problem saying his name because he deserves to be outed. He already has been outed many times. So. Kazi, you're still up? Wow, I'm impressed you're still awake. All right, anyways, guys, hope you enjoyed it. I'll try to do it more often, and I will talk to you guys later. So, bye, everyone. Have a good night or morning or day.